You're listening to The Mark White Show.
That's a good how do you do.
Now celebrating their 65th anniversary, Bob Sykes Barbecue is locally owned and operated by second-generation Van Sykes with the help of his nephew Jason Jewell, third generation of the Bob Sykes family. You can order Bob Sykes Barbecue online at bobsykes.com or visit the drive-thru or dine in. Open Monday through Saturday, closed on Sunday. Catering, family meals, and tailgate specials are available. You can also check out From the Pit to the Plate, the story of Bob Sykes Barbecue book, now available at bobsykes.com or visit the restaurant. That's Bob Sykes Barbecue, located in the heart of Alabama. That's Bob Sykes Barbecue.
Sometimes life brings you a moment you always will remember. Some of nature's most beautiful creations, framed by places we know and cherish. And aren't we in luck that some of life's most memorable scenes are right here at home, all together at Alabama the Beautiful, the group on Facebook, where the eye captures the moment, and it really does last forever.
Be sure to check out AlabamaTheBeautifulMagazine.com.
With six convenient locations to serve you, Bankston Motorhomes is your local RV dealer. They have some of the top brand name RVs for sale at incredible prices. Whether you are looking for an awesome RV for a long-term road trip or a smaller or more lightweight RV for the occasional weekend getaway, Bankston Motorhomes is here to provide you with some outstanding options and deals that you just won't find anywhere else. For more information, go to BankstonMotorhomes.com or visit one of their six convenient locations in Huntsville, Florence, Warrior, Albertville, and Ardmore in Nashville, Tennessee. That's Bankston Motorhomes.
Hey everybody, this is Daryl Worley, and you're listening to The Mark White Show. Hey, step up and make a difference like he does.
This is Nico Johnson from Andalusia, Alabama, assistant football coach at University of Texas. Be where your feet are. You listen to The Mark White Show.
Hey y'all, this is Jeff Foxworthy, and you, yeah, you can make a huge difference in somebody's life. You just may not have figured out how yet, and that's why you're listening to The Mark White Show.
Hi, I'm Crystal Gale, and you're listening to The Mark White Show, and one smile can make a difference.
Hello, I'm Gene Stallings, and this is The Mark White Show. Get off the sideline and get involved and make a difference in your community.
You are listening to The Mark White Show. My daddy is your host, Mark White.
Welcome to an on-location edition of The Mark White Show. I am your host, Mark White, coming to you from Huntsville, Alabama at the Huntsville Library. We appreciate the Huntsville Library having a study room that we could use. As I talked to Keith and Edie Lowhorne, they are grandparents raising grandkids. As you know, my grandparents raised me. An important part of my life was my grandparents taking me in and making me part of their family. Right now, we're talking about Christmas for Ken and how you can help these grandparents provide Christmas for their grandchildren. Welcome to The Mark White Show, Edie and Keith Lowhorne.
Thank you for having us, and thank you for getting this important mission that we're on out to the public.
Absolutely. Always happy to help. Keith, you've been on the show before.
Absolutely, we have, and we appreciate it. We appreciate any time that you give us, and we appreciate you just talking to us about this. This is important, especially this time of year.
Since we last had a conversation, you've been able to reach a lot of people with grandparents as parents.
Absolutely, we have. The pandemic really brought things forward for us because there was such a need that we found in the community that grandparents were suffering. And we were very fortunate that we got involved with two other nonprofits who helped us and still continue to help us. And we have passed out over 55 tons of food to grandparents for the last 2 years, and that equals to about we've reached about 15,000 people. We've done school supplies, we've done Christmas, we've done pajamas, anything that we can get our hands on that will help grandparents in any way, we try to do, and we try to help.
On Monday morning, you were in Decatur. Mm-hmm. Describe how that works. You go and you pick up food.
Yeah, well, on Mondays we pick up a donation from Walmart. Walmart gives us a donation. Or that store indicator gives us a donation, and we go and they pack up stuff that has been returned or things that they can't sell or things that, that come in by mistake and they pass along to us. So you know, it's like Christmas morning. You never know what you're going to get. Sometimes we get clothes. Sometimes we get foods. Sometimes we get bicycles, fans. We just get just a plethora. If Walmart has it, there's a good chance that we would probably get it at some point.
How did that even come about?
Well, that came about because there is a national organization called the 360, and they were big into helping other nonprofits, and they started helping the Alabama Foster and Adoptive Parent Association, and we bought into this situation with the 360, and we have like five Walmarts that help us out right now, scattered throughout North Alabama. And you just never know what you're going to get, and you just go and you just pick up stuff. Sometimes you get a truckload, sometimes you get a truck in your trailer load, sometimes you get a backseat load. You just never know what you're going to get.
You have a route.
Absolutely, yeah, absolutely. Buddy Hooper, who's the president of AFAPA, and I, we have a little. We know where we're going to go on what days, and then there are other days that we just get special calls that say, "Hey, can you come pick up?" And we say, "Absolutely."
One of the last events that my grandmother went to was the Limestone County Foster and Adoptive Parent Association Spaghetti Supper. It was a fundraiser.
Yeah,
it was on a Thursday night. She passed away the next Thursday, but I remember her seeing those children and how drawn she was to them, interacting with the parents who were taking care of those children. And it meant a lot to her because they adopted three children. Mm-hmm. And then, of course, they raised me and my brother.
Wow.
And then she raised my nephew. And she was 84 years old when my nephew was 16, almost 17, when she passed away on March 29th of 2018.
Wow.
She raised three generations.
Yeah.
Of children.
And you would be surprised. There are those out there right now that are doing exactly the same thing. Well, I mean, there are great grandparents that not a week goes by that we haven't found a new great grandparent that is in their late 70s, early 80s that's going through the raising of a family member.
And one of the things I mentioned in a post that I shared on the Facebook page was that when a grandparent takes on a grandchild, it's a little different than, say, the system sends a child to someone to take care of them in a foster situation. If you're taking care of family, the chances of you having financial support from the family that you are assisting is probably not too good.
It's very, very, very nil. It's nil. You get absolutely nothing. A grandparent gets absolutely nothing from the state if they do not go through the formal DHR system, and which the majority of them do not. I mean, the numbers are just so far outrageous that there's you might as well say that there's just very few that are in the DHR system, and those on the outside get very little to no help. You know, if you're fortunate enough and you adopt those grandchildren or whatever the family member may be, and you're and you can get Social Security, then they can be put on your Social Security, which is a real blessing. But for the most part, you're out there on your own. And that's why we have so many people that we try to help, because there are folks out there that are suffering, especially in this day and age when the economy is just, you know, food has just got outrageous. Clothes are outrageous. Anything that these families need, they get. We try to help because they don't get any help from anywhere else.
We can think about the natural progression of things, and let's say a child is born into a home where the child is already living in the grandparents' home, and there is no court involved. It's just that their child had a child, and that child is in that home. It just, the way it is.
It's a generational thing. It's happened for generations. It's happened since the beginning of time that grandparents have raised their grandchildren. And there's a lot of that goes on simply for the fact that they don't want anybody to know about it. They just want it to be they want to be under the table. They don't want to be in the eyes of any government agency. So that's been one of the hurdles that we've had to face, is that we have so many people that are afraid. So that's one of the things that we really are adamant about, that, hey, we're not going to tell anybody about you. You know, we're here to help you and your family and these children. and whether you go through the system or whether you don't go through the system, that's beside the point.
In my situation, my grandparents took me at a very young age off and on. It was kind of like babysitters when necessary. And there were some really long periods of time that they had to babysit. Mm-hmm. The court got involved when a divorce happened. Mm-hmm. Then the court decided, okay, this child goes here, this child goes here. Mark, you've been with your grandparents off and on for this long, so it's best that you go with your grandparents. By 9 years old, my grandparents had guardianship. And so they had the legal system involved, which then provided a small amount of child support through that process. But as we talk about this, that's not the situation for so many.
No, it's rare. It's very rare that most grandparents get little to nothing, if in the way of anything, whether it's help from an educational standpoint, it's help for schools, it's help for daycare, help for anything like that. It's just not out there.
So you saw the problem, Keith. What made you care?
What made us care is because, well, we got two grandchildren. We got these grandchildren that were NAS babies, our neonatal abstinence babies and drug babies. And we were at a crossroads. We didn't know what to do. I mean, you know, from my background in the media, I thought, well, sure, you know, hey, you know, Keith's going to know somebody that's going to be able to help. And, man, everywhere I reached out, it was like, well, what are you talking about? It was just like nobody understood what was going on because of the, I guess, the whole situation. So we knew that we had to do something, and then we found AFAPA, and AFAPA has been just a huge supporter of grandparents as parents, to the point that they have changed their whole system of where they do things, and now kinship is included on everything. So and the numbers are so outrageously different. I mean, you were talking about your grandparents. The number of grandparents that are in the system versus are outside the system, for every one child that's in foster care in the United States, there are 19 children being raised by their grandparents. In Alabama, the numbers are so outrageous. It's for every one child in foster care, 85 are being raised by their grandparents. 85. And we're not by far the highest in the country. We're close to the top, but we're by far not there at all. There's a lot that are worse than we are.
And if those children are being taken care of by grandparents, they're one step away from being in the foster care system. And thanks to these grandparents for taking them and being responsible for their grandkids, they are keeping them from having to be moved from house to house in a foster system.
Absolutely. I mean, yeah, everything from a historical standpoint, everybody knows and understands that it's best to put a child with a relative. I mean, the outcomes are so much better, whether it's educational health, their behavior, their mental health. Everything that they do is so much better if they are with a grandparent or a relative. Because they're stability, and that's by far the best thing that a grandparent gives you, because a grandparent is stable. And so if you're in that grandparent's home, more than likely you're going to have some stability, and that's good for those children. And I can tell you just from the fact that we've had these two since almost 6 years now. Yeah, almost 6 years. Yeah, it was 6 years yesterday.
Congratulations.
Well, it's something definitely we didn't think we were going
to. It's a boy.
It was not. No, in that case, it was a girl.
And a girl.
It was a girl. Okay. It was a girl. Our princess, or whatever she was to be. She's got grandpa wrapped around her finger, that's for sure. But it's the numbers are just so far out there, but things are starting to turn. And I think things are starting to turn for the better, because people are beginning to realize that there are grandparents and there are relatives that are taking care of these children, and they're getting zero help. And that's, I think, is beginning to turn around on a national level. And as soon as politicians realize that grandparents are saving money, when you start thinking about if in the state of Alabama, if all the grandparents put those children into foster care, those 60,000 kids, $7 billion a year is what it would cost the state of Alabama. That it would break the state. It would break the state. There's no way that this state could ever operate with this number of kids. I mean, just the sheer numbers that are in the DHR system now and all the issues that they have, and plus the turnaround with the turnover rate in DHR is just so high these days.
That's why I mentioned that fine line earlier. Right now we're talking to Keith Lowhorne. His wife Edie is with us as well, and we're coming to you from Huntsville Library in Huntsville, Alabama, talking about grandparents as parents. We're also talking about Christmas for kin, and we want to talk about this on the other side as we talk to Edie. She shared some facts with me through an email, and I want to talk some more about that to bring this home. So I hope you'll stick with us. You are listening to The Mark White Show, and I'm your host, Mark White.
We can make a difference. All we have to do is try. Every day's a chance to change somebody else's life. Let's all do something good today.
Athens Bible School is accredited by Advance Ed, a member of the National Alliance of Concurrent Enrollment Partnerships, and is a satellite campus of Calhoun Community College. For more information, call 256-232-3525 or visit our website at athensbibleschool.org.
With 6 convenient locations to serve you, Bankston Motorhomes is your local RV dealer. They have some of the top brand name RVs for sale at incredible prices. Whether you are looking for an awesome RV for a long-term road trip or a smaller or more lightweight RV for the occasional weekend getaway, Bankston Motorhomes is here to provide you with some outstanding options and deals that you just won't find anywhere else. For more information, go to BankstonMotorhomes.com or visit one of their 6 convenient locations in Huntsville, Florence, Warrior, Albertville, and Ardmore in Nashville, Tennessee. That's Bankston Motorhomes.
For those of us who are directly responsible for the care of loved ones, we want to do the very best we can to take care of them. This is where estate planning is so important. With estate planning, you can still take care of your loved ones even when you're gone. I encourage you to make a plan by going to BamaEstatePlanning.com. Harlan Mitchell has all the tools you need to make a solid plan for your family, just like I did. That's BamaEstatePlanning.com. Make a plan and do it today.
No representation is made that the quality of legal services to be performed is greater than the legal services performed by other lawyers.
This is Cora White inviting you to tune in every Saturday to Cora's Corner on The Mark White Show.
Welcome back to The Mark White Show on location in Huntsville, Alabama at Huntsville Library. I do have with me Keith Lowhorne and Edie Lowhorne. Edie shared with me an email, and involved with that was Christmas for Kin, trying to get Christmas for children who are raised by their grandparents. It's a very important effort that I'm glad to be able to share with you today. Welcome to the show, Edie.
Thank you, Mark. Thank you for having us.
Thank you for being here and sharing with me through the email so that I could have more information about this. Obviously, being raised by grandparents myself, it is a concern because I know how close I was to being in foster care. I know how close I was to not having a relative take care of me, but my grandparents fortunately did step in and take responsibility for a child, and I was not easy, but I'm glad that they did it, and I appreciate that. And you as a grandmother, you are raising grandkids yourself.
We're raising 2. Never expected it. And when we did get custody of them, we thought that it was going to be temporary, but soon realized it was going to be permanent. And like Keith had shared a little while earlier, I'm a Google fanatic. And if I don't have an answer to something and can't, I go to Google. If I can't find it, I just delve deeper. And I started looking for help for anything that we could get. I mean, we didn't have clothes for these babies. We didn't have furniture. We did have friends that started calling us and saying, I've got a crib I'm not using, those kind of things. And I thought there has to be help for grandparents. And there wasn't. And I started meeting more grandparents that were in the same situation as us. And then Christmas came. And Christmas is, Keith can tell you, I am a Christmas fanatic. And Christmas has always been my favorite time of the year. And we had someone reach out to us and said, we want to do Christmas for your kids. You can't imagine how I cried and how thankful I was. And then we started hearing from other people, like, we don't get help for Christmas. How can we get help for Christmas? And I told Keith, I said, if we don't do anything else, I want to help these grandparents provide Christmas for their kids. And we knew we financially could not do it. So we've mulled over it, and we've helped here and there and had some help here and there. But this year, after Christmas last year, I decided this year I wanted to find sponsors, get donations to provide Christmas. We had about 300 people turn in lists to us last year. If you can help, please just help. So our goal is 300 kids this year. And if we can get sponsors to take one child, siblings, if you want to adopt the whole family and provide Christmas dinner, we're looking at church groups, businesses, anybody that will help sponsor a child for Christmas.
We won't turn anybody down.
That's right. We won't turn anybody down. We've had some cash donations. We've had people come forward and say, you know, can you give us a list? Can you give us two lists? Our Sunday school group wants to do it. I had a Girl Scout leader reach out, and she's going to see if she can't get the parents to come together. Anybody that wants to sponsor a child, if anybody wants to make a cash donation, we'll do the shopping. We're looking for businesses that, at the end of the year, they need to make a tax donation. We'll take it.
On my show, I try to talk about thinking outside of ourselves. And all of us have had opportunities to receive, be on the receiving end. Even if someone doesn't consider it that great of a gift that they received, everybody's received something.
Yes.
And for us to think about what we received and then say, I want to offer that to someone else, that's a different step than taking. Mm-hmm. And it's okay to take. I think there's a time for people to receive and to take. I also think there's a time for us to think about what we've taken and what we've received and think about what we can do. And no, you didn't have the money to provide for 300 kids across Alabama. But if you pull your resources together and you network, then it's very possible to provide Christmas for 300 children across Alabama.
I know it's possible, and we've just got to find those resources. Yeah. And there's more than 300. That's just our goal for this year. This is our starting point. If we had enough resources and we could get 500 kids taken care of this Christmas, we could do it in a heartbeat. There are that many that we could provide for if we had the resources.
Go ahead, Keith.
One thing that we're trying to do, Mark, is that we feel that to grow, we've established what I might call satellite areas that have food pantries, that have clothes pantries, that have those things that grandparents need in other parts of the state as well. So, you know, we've got two in Madison County. We've got one in Lauderdale, Colbert County. We've got one in Montgomery. We've got one in Tuscaloosa, and we've got one in Mobile, or Daphne. And Mobile and Daphne are so close together that they use it. So all those areas, grandparents are suffering. So in all those areas, those grandparents need Christmas. And we know that we can't provide Christmas for the thousands that need it, but we need to at least be able to start in a manner that's small and watch ourselves grow, because there is a lot to it. I mean, it's not something that you know, Edie does a lot. Edie does 99.9% of it, and it's a job. It really is.
We're starting. The reason we set our goal for 300 is because that's about how many people we hear from on the average in North Alabama. And because we live in North Alabama, of course, it's easier for us to start here. But we actually had a phone call this morning from someone in Daphne. She's part of a grandparent group, and they were asking for help for Christmas. And, of course, we had to tell them, we'll do what we can do, but we've got to start close to home. And if we get enough sponsors, then we can work our way down. It's hard to tell somebody you don't have the resource for them, especially when it's a grandparent who's reaching out and can't provide, you know, Christmas for their kid, and the child's going to wake up Christmas morning And I'm sure that they can probably go and get a few little small gifts, but not the Christmas that every child wants to wake up and have this wide-eyed wonder and the Christmas presents that they've been hoping they could get. And then they have to go to school, you know, after Christmas break, and the other kids are talking about what they got for Christmas. And we want the children in care of a relative to be able to go to school and have that same excitement and, you know, wake up Christmas morning with the same excitement that every child they know gets to wake up to.
How do you get others involved? If we talk about the entire state of Alabama, and you both are from North Alabama and Central Alabama down to South Alabama, you've got a pretty big area from Ardmore, Alabama, down to Mobile, Bay Minette, wherever you want to describe as South Alabama. It's a big, big state from east to west, north to south.
I don't know how to use hashtags, but my new one is hashtag goals. And I was actually talking to a friend in Montgomery who has goals that I'm trying to meet myself. And I told her the other night, talking to her, that I want to be like her when I grow up, because she single-handedly, through the DHR system, is providing Christmas through donations for 400 children this year. But she's got the resources. And I did. I told her I want to be like you when I grow up. We really don't know the answer to that question. We have to take baby steps, and we'll just grow it. And I don't have an answer to that question, to be honest with you, but I would love, you know, I can say Santa Claus is going to have to get busy and fly super fast that night, but...
I think, Mark, that what a lot of people don't realize the problem. A lot of people, you know, just think that grandparents are raising their grandchildren. Nah, it's okay. Grandparents are the retire, they get money from blah, 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 or blah, 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 and they should have money to raise these children. Where it's not, because the majority of the grandparents that are raising their grandchildren are in poverty, below the poverty level. So these people need help. So what would be ideal for us is if we could find that champion. You know, we need that champion that maybe was possibly raised by their grandparents, somebody that understands that, hey, there is people out there that are like me that we may be able to help. And that's what we just need, those champions out there that understand that we love our foster care system, we love the families that we serve, and we love what DHR is doing within the system, but there are so many that are outside the system that are reaching out and need help. You know, the DHR provides the stipends for those families. Grandparents get nothing. You know, it's there's Christmas provided by a lot of groups for foster families, because they probably don't know that the grandparents are suffering. But that's the key, that we have to get the word out that grandparents are suffering through this. And it's not a new phenomenon. It's been going on since the beginning of time. But, man, it's getting more. There's not a day that goes by that we do not have a new parent, grandparent reach out to us and say, help, what do I do?
Looking at this, Alabama Foster and Adoptive Parent Association, it looks like they've made room for this effort,
yes,
for grandparents raising grandkids.
Yeah.
Because when you look at Alabama Foster and Adoptive, that's very specific.
Yeah.
Foster,
yeah,
and adoptive. And a lot of grandparents, as we mentioned, they haven't adopted,
yeah,
and it's not a foster kid.
Right.
They may have guardianship, maybe, but most likely not. And if Alabama Foster and Adoptive Parent Association has made room, maybe there's other organizations that can make room as well. I know I deal with CASA in the Shoals,
yeah,
and then also Kids to Love, had,
yeah,
Lee Marshall on the,
mm-hmm,
program to talk about,
mm-hmm,
foster kids.
Mm-hmm.
These are foster kids in a sense, and the care and concern that is shown to foster kids, we have to make a way so that these other children who are that step away from being foster kids themselves are provided for and,
yeah,
taken care of.
The grandparents are saving those children from moving into a foster home, because there's not enough foster homes now already. So if all of a sudden you put 60,000 more children into that system, the system would probably break.
Yes.
I mean, I don't know where these kids would go. There's not enough group homes. There's not enough this. There's not enough that. Plus, there's not enough funding to take care of them.
So how about we help with these 300 and get this goal met? How do we do that? People who are listening right now, how can they help you reach the 300 and beyond?
Well, we have a list for every one of these children. The kids have made out their Christmas list like they would be sending it to Santa Claus. We can gladly send people a list if they want a specific age, gender, whatever. they can make donations to us through cash or gift cards, and we can do the shopping.
Or we have other people do shopping for us as well.
Yes, we've had some friends and volunteers that have said, you know, I know it's a lot. We'll be glad to go help you do the shopping. There's just all kinds of ways. We do PayPal. We can take checks. We can take cash. We can do Venmo.
You set up a specific email address where people can reach out to you, right?
We've had the email address for quite a while. Okay. It's all one word, all lowercase, alabamagrandfamilies@yahoo.com. Everything is spelled out.
alabamagrandfamilies@yahoo.com.
Correct.
We want people to email you.
Yes, they can email me there to ask questions. They can email me to ask how they can help. They can email to say, you know, we want 20 kids to sponsor. we want one child to sponsor.
Or if they want to call me, I'd be glad to talk to anyone about this situation or if, however anybody would like to help. And I'm gladly give out my phone number. It's 256-698-2297. 256-698-2297. And if you're a grandparent out there and you are raising your grandchildren, give us a call. I mean, we want to help you. We know you're out there, and we might be able to help you in some form, shape, or fashion. So give us a call.
In Alabama, 200,000 children are being raised by a relative, mainly grandparents. And for every one child in foster care, 88 are being raised by grandparents with no assistance. Many grandparents live on just Social Security, which leaves them below the poverty level. We want to help support 300 grand families for Christmas this year through Grandparents as Parents, and thanks to the Alabama Foster and Adoptive Parent Association Christmas for Kin effort. And we appreciate you, Keith and Edie, for joining me here on the Mark White Show today.
Well, we're glad to be here, and we appreciate it.
Yes, thank you for having us, and we hope this word gets out and we have people reach out who need help as well as want to help.
Absolutely. Here on the Mark White Show, we're recognizing difference makers and sharing stories to encourage and inspire. I hope you are encouraged enough now to share this with your family, your friends, and your neighbors, and find a way that you can support Christmas for Kin this year as we help these grandparents who are raising grandchildren. I want you to follow The Mark White Show on Facebook and Instagram and subscribe to The Mark White Show podcast wherever you get your podcast. You have been listening to another edition of The Mark White Show, and this is Mark White encouraging you to find your purpose by making a difference in someone's life today.
There are moments in life you wish you could capture forever. Alabama the Beautiful is a new online magazine that preserves images from sweet home Alabama. Yours anytime, online, every month. Where the eye captures the moment, and it really does last forever.
Be sure to check out alabamathebeautifulmagazine.com.
Thompson Roofing and Construction is a locally owned family business serving the North Alabama and Southern Tennessee area. They are a Better Business Bureau A-plus member since 2011 and a GAF Master Elite Contractor. Give them a call at 256-952-3309 or check them out on the web at 256roofing.com. They offer free inspections.
Thompson Roofing and Construction.
Mr. Cecil Batchelor is the one that started this business as Dependable Service Center. And even though now it's Green's Dependable Hardware and we're a True Value store, our tagline is still your Dependable Service Center. We've tried to keep that alive for all these years. Mr. Batchelor really started a good business. We're really excited to be carrying on a long-standing tradition. It's the oldest retail store in the city of Russellville. We're Green's Dependable Hardware, 15220A Highway 43 in Russellville, Alabama. We're right behind McDonald's or right across the street from the hospital. Number is 256-331-0123.
Your Dependable Service Center.
Is it time for a haircut? Give my friend Philip Butler at Southwind Barbershop a call, located in Rogersville, Alabama. You can call him at 256-247-5658. Make an appointment or just walk in. That's Southwind Barbershop in Rogersville, Alabama.
Nice and gentle people who shout a friendly hi when they go passing by, who live and love in my home.